Now, this project called the Highland Hemp House was in Bellingham, Washington. A totally different style of construction from the Idaho Base Camp project, sort of conventionally framed, but it was also an addition, renovation, and a retrofit. So this project, again, sort of opened up a new element of how hempcrete could be used. And what was considered is, how does hempcrete integrate with a frame that's pre-existing? How do you annex off of that frame with conventional framing? But also, how do you frame for a hempcrete building that is of this size? Using my sort of experience gathered from working in conventional construction, I was actually hired as the sort of framing foreman with locally hired labor to build this house in Bellingham, Washington. And I think that's important to point out, because going back to that sort of metaphor, you're not going to frame out a house conventionally and decide to put straw bale in it. You decide from day one you're going to build a straw bale house. The envelope for hempcrete has to be considered. The framing has to work with hempcrete. And so I got myself into a bit of a mess here. I moved out to Bellingham to work on this project. We did have absolutely outrageous views, which only increased as the project went on. But you know, realizing all the layers of the onion of this original house, it was tough to work through this and build from the foundation up. But I think considering hempcrete from the foundation up is absolutely imperative. So on day 10, I think I spent my first week sort of chiseling out bedrock from the basement, looking to put in new sonotube foundations and footers to support the new loads above. It was a tough job, but you know, making some progress on the framing. All of this framing was done to consider the incorporation of hempcrete around it. You're going to notice that there is not any shear panel on the exterior of this building. Where you will see shear panel, OSB, is generally on the inside. If you look sort of on the first story there, you can see some interior shear walls. That's because hempcrete wall assemblies are vapor open. They need to be able to pass vapor through them. OSB and plywood generally interfere with that process. So shear walls and your structural engineering of a hempcrete building are also a challenge in their own right. You'll also notice that there's some diagonal bracing going on that's mounted onto just sort of the outside of the framing. Day 100, you know, figuring out how to build a curved fascia was quite an exciting challenge. But you'll notice that, you know, we have some sort of open voids here, and I call out attentions to the corners on the second story above the sort of there's a door opening that would lead out to a deck. There's, you know, posts on either side of that door. Well, how do you get shear value for a hempcrete building without having plywood or, you know, a structural substrate on the outside? The answer generally is X braces. So we had some zones that were left open for essentially a sort of hybridized commercial style X bracing system using gusset plates, you know, steel X braces that were essentially prefabricated in a shop and then installed on site. Gave our corners the rigidity that was needed. While we're still on this framing photo, another thing that I just want to point out is that hempcrete is usually cast with depth. You're very rarely, if never, building a hempcrete wall that's just matching the depth of your stud. So you wouldn't have a 2x4 or 2x6 depth of hempcrete. For a few reasons, one of which is that the thermal performance most likely wouldn't be sufficient. But the beauty of hempcrete is that it can eliminate all of your thermal bridging. So this entire house was framed out with the idea of a frame on center. meaning we had essentially an 11 and a half inch wall. So our bottom plates were 11 and a half inches. Our studs were laid out on center, and where we had 2x4 studs, that left about 3 7/8 inches on either side of the stud to the finished or to the unfinished surface of hempcrete before plaster. So all that has to be even factored into your overhangs. You know, to if you want your overhangs to be a certain distance, you have to consider, hey, my finished material is going to come out 4 inches, 4 3/4 inches past where my structural frame is. But in building this house and becoming intimately aware of sort of the nuances and challenges that it would take to incorporate hempcrete on this, we started to look at the project with sort of a systems thinking approach. In general, systems thinking is a disciplined approach for examining problems more completely and accurately before acting. And so what that meant to us is, hey, we have thousands of pounds of material that has to get mixed and batched on site. It has to get brought to the wall itself. It has to get placed in these wall forms and then tamped down into place. How do we do that, you know, on a three-story building efficiently and effectively? And so this systems thinking approach caused us to kind of take some time and actually plan out the hempcrete installation, which I cannot emphasize enough the critical elements of planning a hempcrete construction process, because once you start, you really want to keep going. It's kind of like concrete in the sense of once you start pouring concrete, you don't want to just stop in the middle of it and come back later and finish the rest. So we use technology to our advantage. We had a series of mixers that were working together. We had remote controlled operated winches that were bringing this material up to our higher stories. And we're also using conveyor belts, systems that would allow us to distribute this material, which looks very much so like wet wood chips when it's first mixed, into the wall cavity. The really labor intensive elements of hempcrete ultimately come from the mixing process, the forming process, but then the last quadrant there on the looker's bottom right is tamping the material into place. All material has to be tamped into place to give it this sort of stamped aesthetic that you can see here. The hempcrete is brought up to the rafters, touching the subfloor above, creating continuous insulation. We use conveyor belts to move this material around to get it inside, but now you can see the structural frame is essentially vanished. That's because it is on center to our wall, meaning we have no thermal bridging in this assembly. There you see one of our team members removing a form board on our two-story curved wall. And you can see we are relatively spread out across this house installing the hempcrete in it. It certainly has a beautiful aesthetic, almost kind of like rammed earth. Ultimately, the end product for this project looked like this. You can actually see the end product for our scope of work, the hempcrete installation, looked like this. You can actually, if you note, see the stratification of the hempcrete itself. In particular, that two-story curved wall is a southern-facing aspect, kind of causing the surface to dry out a little bit more quickly, which ultimately doesn't affect the material as a whole, but it does sort of bring out that stratification of the material. Every single course of this product in this style of construction with hemp is tamped into place. And we would call this method cast in place. It's sort of an artisanal, high-end, high-quality approach that is indeed very labor-intensive. However, kind of results in what I would say is the highest quality outcome for hempcrete. Quickly, I'll just call attention to the door on the second story deck. You can really get a sense of that hempcrete encapsulating the frame with that frame being buried on center. Of course, I'm sure the architects out there are thinking about the detailing that is invoked when you have an inset door or window frame, and certainly with this construction method, there are some considerations to be had when you are flashing, waterproofing, installing windows and doors that are on center to a wall system like this. Ultimately, the house has a number of solar panels, and they are producing more energy than they use today. So the Highland Hemp House, by the numbers, it was a labor-intensive process. About 1,500 hours, man hours, went into this project. When we say hemp aggregate, we're referring to hemp core, which goes back to that idea of you're combining the wooden core of the hemp stock, which is very processed for this use. You're combining it with a lime-based binder, in this case, primarily hydrated lime and a pozzolan. 12,000 pounds of hemp aggregate, 23,000 pounds of lime binder. And ultimately, this offset, we estimate to be about 15,372 pounds of carbon dioxide. That does not consider, you know, the sort of on-site considerations. For instance, our mixer is gas-powered. We were using electricity constantly to power our tools, charge our batteries. This statistic solely relates to the generalized statistic that one cubic foot of hempcrete offsets about 7 pounds of carbon dioxide. So this was a really exciting project, kind of a showcase project, and there have not been other building projects of this magnitude really conducted in the United States. So kind of challenge us to think about, you know, what's possible with this material. But aside from cast in place, there are other methods of installing hempcrete. Just this past summer, we partnered with a French inventor who created a spray applied projection system that allows the spray application of hempcrete into a wall cavity. So to put this into perspective, the cast in place method of installing hempcrete, you're looking at about 10 to 15 cubic feet of material installed per hour. Whereas with this spray applied method, you're looking at about 50 to 60 cubic feet installed per hour. By no means is it perfect. It's certainly a faster, potentially messier means of installing hempcrete, but still a bit of a leap forward from this idea of hempcrete only being reserved for, you know, the people that are that 1% I alluded to before, the overlapping diagram of sustainably motivated yet financially able. Ultimately, using this spray machine and system would lower your costs. You'll lower your on-site time, but your wall assembly is going to be a little bit different. You can see in this method, we are actually spraying against a substrate. That substrate is a material that is called magnesium oxide board. Magnesium oxide board is essentially compressed magnesium. And the reason that we're using magnesium oxide board in this method is because magnesium oxide board is vapor permeable. It allows moisture to pass through it without any degradation to the material itself. And at the same time, it's serving as our shear panel and ultimately our interior substrate for finish. So with the spray system, you have to have, and this actually goes for really any type of hemp building process that's using hempcrete, your conduit, your wiring, everything has to be encapsulated in what we call Smurf tube, which is indicated there in the blue tubing. So it has to be run through that. So if you ever want to make changes later on, you have essentially a highway to snake your material or wiring through. Moving on from the spray applied projection system, which one last note on the spray applied projection system, I would certainly recommend sort of a double stud construction for this style. You never see spray foam that looks pretty. And it's not that this method doesn't look pretty, it's just that it's a little bit more challenging to finish out. So you could sort of blow and go on a double stud wall assembly, have your hempcrete hidden, and it doesn't matter the finished surface or how it looks. Moving on to just a kind of quick demo construction project that we did. We built a panelized tiny house, and we wanted to experiment with the idea of prefabricated elements that would be constructed in one location and then ultimately brought to another location. By casting these panels flat with a mixer nearby, we were able to just essentially dump the hempcrete right into the panels without having to fight gravity. We allowed the panels to dry, and then we brought them to a very remote and rural site where we essentially raised these panels. We could not get a crane here, but of course, if this were done on a larger scale, you could essentially strap these panels up or, you know, have them on a forklift and set them on a foundation quickly and easily. You'll notice that the exterior of this small build is also magnesium oxide board, which I think is worth pointing out is fireproof. So we're cladding a fireproof material, hempcrete, with a fireproof cladding, magnesium oxide board. This ended up being particularly valuable because during the construction process of this house, and I'm very proud to say I was not the originator of this brush fire, but a neighbor nearby started a brush fire that scorched all of the sagebrush surrounding the home. And we were very pleased because the house itself, although it has a timber roof, would be not susceptible to the fires, which seem to be a sort of growing concern in this area.
Thanks for watching. Please continue to watch the next part of the session to complete the course and get your continuing education credits. Be sure to check out all of our courses available online that you can watch anytime and anywhere to pick up your CEUs. Before you go, make sure to subscribe to us on YouTube to get weekly updates and stay up to date on green building science courses, webinars, and home tours. Thanks again.